This is ThinkTech Hawaii. Community matters here.
It is noon, folks, Thursday, noontime, our show, ThinkTech Hawaii show, Where the Drone Leads. Ted Ralston here. Happen to be in our Arctic Circle studio today, the Arctic Circle studio in Fairbanks, Alaska, the most northern reach of ThinkTech Hawaii. And why we're here in Alaska, of all places, is to track down and finally get on the show in the flesh. For the first time on the flesh, welcome aboard to the show, George Purdy. You've been on the show many times by Skype, but never in flesh. Now we got you today. No, you're in Lanai, but we got you here in Fairbanks.
Yes, from Lanai to Vegas to Fairbanks.
So last week, if we wanted you on the show, we would have had to find you in Fairbanks. I mean, in Vegas.
Yes.
Okay, but we got you here.
Yes.
All right. So anyway, we're welcoming George Purdy on the show here in our Fairbanks, Alaska studio. And one thing I want to point out to the people is if we're doing this outside in Fairbanks, Alaska, there is an outside here, and the sun does shine, the flowers do grow, and the grass is green. It looks like Hawaii in a lot of respects right now, George. I think in 2 months that won't be the case.
No.
Okay, and you and I aren't going to be outside here much longer. No. We're freezing already. Anyway, George is one of our most fascinating aficionados and advocates of unmanned air systems, drones, UAS, RPA, whatever you want to call them, out of Lanai, and that leadership that George has expressed is well known, frankly, across the nation and the world in the world of UAS. He'll be speaking today at a conference here in Fairbanks.
Yes.
And you'll be speaking on what, George, today?
We're going to talk about the history of what we've done in Hawaii, and to move things forward, I'm really pushing on that the STEM education, UAVs, need to be in our schools. That's a missing link to really move things forward.
So you're talking a lot about, when you say school, you really mean not just the kids and the teachers, but also the parents and the families.
Yes.
So there's a whole STEM continuity here.
Yeah. To move UAS, it takes the whole village. We all need to understand, all need to agree that these are tools for good. Watching the hurricane that hit Florida this week, Harvey, seeing lots of the, watching and understanding the events that's happening and how UASs are actually helping communities get back on their feet, you know, protecting first responders. Things are really moving. Hurricane Harvey really broke the glass ceiling for emergency response in using UAS. So that's amazing.
So how do we take that experience that's taking place in Harvey and in Irma and other areas, and how do we package that up and bring it to Hawaii and capitalize on it in our own environment?
I'll be more than happy to come, bring all the emergency responders together, our legislatures together, and then give them a brief summary of our travels here from Vegas to Alaska and coming on back. The other one is you folks can watch on my Facebook page. I have videotaped from Interdrone to Alaska, all these wonderful sessions and wonderful speakers, very positive, forward-looking, and things that drones are doing good.
And that's a good point to be made here. This conference that we're both attending here in Alaska is put on by the University of Alaska Fairbanks. It's an annual workshop of the UAS users group, and people come together to share information, to develop new information, take things away. We're giving information from Hawaii to their benefit, and they're going to give information back to us.
Yes, I mean, I've met some great people through some of the presentations, gave me new ideas that I had an idea back home, and then now I found the missing puzzle piece, and I'm going to share it when I get back home and get some things done.
I do have to say that one of the rules we have on the show, George, no more than 3 bright ideas from you in a half-hour session, because that's all we can handle. And so you've already hit one. Actually, you probably have hit 2 already, so we're very at the beginning of the show, and you are already at your limit of bright ideas. But let me take you up on the idea you just had. Let's develop that further. Taking the essence of what you're learning about Irma and about Harvey through the interactions in Vegas and through the interactions here, packaging that up in an understandable sense that can be delivered in 4 or 5 minutes quickly to our legislature. This would be really useful prior to the 2018 legislative session beginning.
It is. The key one that I found out is why FEMA sometimes does not pay the monies to help restore a community. I found out that in a contract that when you receive that money has to go back to the community and restore what was destroyed exactly the way it was. What I found out from a Texas fire department, as part of their training, they went out with their drones and they 3D mapped certain areas that they thought they would have problems. Now they take that 3D mapping and they attach it to their request to receive the monies back. They actually have evidence on how to put back what was destroyed.
So the idea there would be to take that same idea of drone recording of your particular INA, your house, your laydown, your land, and get that in the books ahead of time, because that's the framework upon which FEMA will generate a payment to you through your insurance system,
yes,
or their insurance system, in order for you to restore. But if you don't have that, then
you're
not going to get there.
You're not going to get there. And the other part is not only FEMA, it's just your local fire department understanding their environment. You know, we have firemen that rotate in and out of the fire station. It's a great map when you show up to shift to look to see any changes, what's new. And it's just a great way for the fire department to be out in the community, flying, mapping, and understanding their environment.
Okay, now this is now the third bright idea, and we're into the first 5 minutes of the show. We got to shut you down after
okay.
this one. But these are great ideas. So get the fire department involved in the community, recording information that's of the community's benefit.
Yes.
The community will benefit, the fire department will benefit, everybody will benefit from that pre-recording of what's out there, the current state of the community. And get that on three-dimensional identification through various software routines that attach to the imagery collected, and have that. That's a complete new function for the fire department.
It is. It's a step above. We already, as firemen, go on in what we call pre-fire planning buildings and walls and offices. This is just taking it to the next level of detailed information. Now that we know what FEMA is asking when we need to declare that declaration, we now know that we can support our community with this information and restoring it back to what it was.
And that would actually lead to us in Hawaii thinking with the school groups and such to develop particular software that's useful to express the Hawaii agricultural and architectural and residential structural laydown in a way that would be an application of some of the software that's out there. Well, we could have sort of customized Hawaii packages.
We can actually get some of these kids, and you know, if we look back in our history and our kupuna, they understand the land. That is what we will do when we go back home, is express to the kids that how about creating it with the Hawaiian sense involved. We know our place, we know our location, we know who we are.
See, maybe you could either start at the school and work out from there, from the school into the community, and generate these maps that grow and finally connect with each other, have a good depiction of the places where people live, where people are affected, and have that as something promoted by the fire department, university helping, the schools helping, and this would also lead to a almost a big data framework, because someone has to own all this information, someone has to retain it, and as things change, if there's a new construction going on or housing development goes in or something, or the sea or the shoreline advances,
yeah,
whatever it might be, that has to be then re-recorded and created. And then you have a picture for all time that's consistent.
Yeah, but you mentioned a good one, Ted, with kids in schools. So you're at kids.
Yeah, I have a lot of bright ideas,
yes,
too.
Yes, you are, and
okay.
I'm going to give you that one. The kids in schools that are helping to develop these maps for the fire department, one thing that's nice about that, these kids are known by the people that live in their community. They know the children, they ask permission, I can guarantee you that they'll probably say, yes, go ahead and map my neighborhood.
But we can start with the schools. The schools,
yes,
are almost a no-brainer. Everybody owns the school. The kids own it, teachers own it, parents own it, everybody gets something out of it. So we start with the schools, map them out, and then work our way into the community.
Yes, and the best part is that the school framework will help with their advancement and understanding of drones, and then they'll go home and teach their parents and their community that it's not a bad thing. It'll save us in the future.
And actually, we can also begin developing policy and doctrine in that regard, because as we do this, there's going to be the recording of information that's, some might consider it private information about your particular property as such. So we have to find ways that it's okay to record that and control the access to it, so the fire department can get access to it, or the insurance underwriters and FEMA can get access to it. But you don't necessarily want to have free and unlimited access to it.
No.
So we have to structure a well thought through information security program associated with this.
Yep. As long as it's public access and we do it in a correct manner and you let the public say, yes, this is what I want, I think with the kids' advocates saying that they created this, I think they'll do it, you know, especially for the long haul and saving lives. I mean, where's the balance in that? I think I would rather go and protect lives.
You know, you're going to be talking later on in this particular conference, either today or tomorrow, about community involvement. Bring this idea up in that discussion. I think this would be a great way to test it right here with this bunch here. We get people from all over the country here. See what they think about that idea.
We'll do if I remember, because I got
I'll certainly call it to your attention. And so let's talk about the other things you're going to be speaking of in this world of community involvement, which is probably the most essential piece. You get the technology, there's no problem there. But the issue is getting past all the social issues, the questions, and the policy issues. But community involvement is, once again, the mechanism to go forward. If you're thinking about that, you're going to be talking about that at this conference today.
Yeah, so as soon as I came up, I think the last year at the other conference, I brought up about drone racing, and I told them about all the school programs in Hawaii. This year, I'm speaking on one panel about drone racing, how it can help the kids, how it increases their piloting skills. And then they were mentioning that when it's freezing here, they've got big buildings, nobody can do really anything, but they're looking at drone racing for indoors, that they can go and race. And they like the technology that now they can race other schools in other buildings through using the internet and race on time. So I'll be explaining a lot on the products, what to get, how to get started. And I'm excited that something that I shared last year, that they're actually doing it.
So you'll be talking about that today. And this is unique. You're talking about an internal, inside, in the building sport activity that can take place in Alaska in buildings you couldn't otherwise use.
Yep.
And you can't do anything outside of the ski.
Yep.
And so promoting a scholastic lead on a given reference race course, so times mean something, and the structure of the course must be the same, I would guess, from place to place.
Yep.
In such a way that you can have a common scoring system. This would be a whole new domain that hasn't occurred here.
No, and then the other part that they like about the racing drones, as small as it is, it's the STEM aspect of what it relates to. And they had these professors that were saying it at the professor PhD level. And, you know, I understand the words, but for me to speak the words, they were up there. They totally get it, and they're excited about it.
You know, you could think of all the technology that could be developed through that kind of a situation. For example, in addition to just simply manually flying the racing drone through the visual cognition and the hand manipulation of the controls, it would be interesting to begin introducing sense and avoid technology into the game for the purpose of speeding up the racing, but also to develop that capability, because what racers need in order to finish the course is not hit something. It's sense and avoid, detect and avoid, all those mechanizations of what we call due regard and such would be a great place to develop that. And then it would have a way to work its way out into the world of environment and economics, and coastal erosion and economic use of the UAV. You can start with the racing side, you STEM as the argument, and build out, plus you train the workforce.
That's it. So as a company, as future policemen, firemen, emergency management, your local filmmakers, it just opens up new doors that we really need in Hawaii.
And the piece that comes back all many times when we speak about business in Hawaii is that this is an aspect of the, what you might call the aerospace business, that has a place to settle down in Hawaii, because we're not talking about big airplanes. We're talking about small systems, software-rich systems that are small and miniaturized. They equally subject to manufacturing in Hawaii as anywhere else, because air shipment can handle them. They're not big parts. So it really becomes a new piece in the economic equation for Hawaii if we do this right.
Yeah. I remember the aerospace conference. A lot of the aerospace folks said that we needed to beef up our educational system, and that's why I'm really pushing STEM in the schools, that it should be STEM all day, not after-school programs for us outer islands. We need to step it up a notch, just like drones are moving today.
So what we can do there is take the emergence of drones and the way you're thinking of it and associate it with the more conventional standard class structure and have a way that the STEM and the drone component within can enhance English, history, math, particular in science. So this could become a new connectivity that ties together the educational framework.
I believe so.
So how do we do that? Is that part of your conversation today?
That is part of my conversation pretty much this whole 4 days here so far. I mean, everything always led back to education and educating the youth. Us as adults, we have gone as far as we can.
Some of us have gone a lot further than we can.
Yep. And I hear the same story, so I want to break that loop that we're in and add something different. And I've been at this for 3 years, and I've always mentioned the kids in my 333 exemption. It was written. I was the first exemption holder to actually talk about STEM. That's 3 years ago. But STEM is the key. The kids are the key to this future, this industry, and just life in general to make Hawaii a much better place.
What do we have to do, and I say we in a broader sense, in order to implement something like that on Lanai starting next year?
Good question. After I go home and I actually can download everything on this two-week, three-week trip, then I'll actually get back and going. But Women in Technology really has been holding down the fort with all the schools, with all the drone programs in there. Those teachers are excited for when I get back. And then once I can regroup, get a conference call, we will get on it and start that MIL drone racing league for the kids at school.
So it's still going to be the drone racing league concept as the operational framework, and the STEM attaches to that, and the subject matter taught in the traditional classifications of education fit that in some way. So that's what you're going to do. Once again, George, your brilliance is using a really powerful and compelling argument, drone racing, as this new connector that ties everything together.
Yeah, I couldn't do this by myself. There's many teachers now that through education, through me telling my stories and seeing that I'm an advocate and really putting our kids first, you know, without their help, we wouldn't get these programs up and going. It is growing by the minute, by the days, and we're going to be successful. And hopefully this legislation season, we actually get a comprehensive bill that is written smartly and is factually, and it'll move us forward.
That's great. So that sounds like a high challenge, and the legislation session begins basically in December. And so all advocacy has to be pretty much lined up and in place by then. That gives us 2 months, October, November, and December to tie it all together. So we're right around the corner.
We have a lot of positive articles throughout the nation now and in Hawaii that I'm coming back with more information with facts that I think we can convince them that this is the right bill to put forward when we get it down on paper.
Cool. And what in your mind would be the theme of the bill?
The theme of the bill would be to adopt FAA's rules in its entirety and create where that is now our foundation. And then from there, we build on the state laws on how the departments in Hawaii and the community will adjust or create anything to benefit or protect the communities in general.
You know, once again, George, this is a great idea, taking the FAA constraints and whatever other constraints it might be from state and local laws, using that as a framework to construct this program. So that's where it starts. It starts with a totally conforming program rather than some bright idea that has to be modified later on to conform.
Yes.
So once again, I think that's the fourth bright idea in this short period of time, so we're over your limit already. And let's think about that in the second half of the show. We'll take a one-minute break here and come back and talk about that very issue of how the constraints can be used as guidance and as a channel into that future. And we come back from our break.
This is ThinkTech Hawaii, raising public awareness.
Aloha. My name is Mark Shklov. I am the host of ThinkTech Hawaii's Law Across the Sea. Law Across the Sea comes on every other Monday at 11 a.m. Please join us. I like to bring in guests that talk about all types of things that come across the sea to Hawaii. Not just law, love, people, ideas, history. Please join us for Law Across the Sea. Aloha.
Guys, don't forget to check me out right here, The Prince of Investing. I'm your host, Prince Dykes. Each and every Tuesdays at 11 a.m. Hawaii time, I'm going to be right here. Stop by and hear from some of the best investment minds across the globe in real estate, finances, stocks, hedge funds, managers, all that great stuff. Thank you.
We are back, folks. Ted Ralston here and George Purdy in the Arctic Circle studio of ThinkTech Hawaii, where temporarily for the day we moved the entire studio of Suite 888 up here to the Arctic Circle because it is the end of the summer up here and a brilliant, great time to be in Alaska with all the green grass and the flowers and
Aloha shirts
on George Purdy. We finally traced him down from Lanai and found him up here in Fairbanks. But we're talking about a great vision George has to take this subject we talk about on this show a lot, which is drones. But normally we talk about a subject like regulations or some technology piece or some narrow piece that's easy to grab onto. You're bringing to us, George, once again, an idea that's so broad that it is difficult, A, to grab onto in a single sense, and B, difficult to resist because it's such a good idea. I can restate your idea because I have to restate things a lot when they're complicated so I can understand it myself. But we're talking about using the rules and the compliance requirements and the constraints that are being generated that control the entire drone functionality and the drone business. Use that instead of as a barrier. Use that as a channel.
As a channel. Exactly.
Design systems in the school system, educational systems using STEM and drones within those constrained channels as a perfectly acceptable way to go forward. Don't challenge the rules. Work with them.
That's it. Those rules are in place not to hinder us, but through education, we will eliminate the ignorance of us not understanding. So you break it down. A school. That's why we have schools. That's where you actually learn about things and understand them, and then you implement them.
And so this would then give a totally conforming way to make drones not violate any of the issues that are associated
that are currently
with them.
Happening. Yep.
It also teach people how to think about compliance.
Yes.
If there are better ways to generate compliance, because if we could think about the effect we're generating rather than the rule itself necessarily, we could come up with waves of improvement in the way rules are structured in the case of drones.
I mean, being on this drone journey for the last 4 or 5 years.
How did you start on this journey?
I got started on this journey because I worked and lived on Lanai at a fire station that only had one man. Our professional resources come from another island. And as I seen this technology emerge, I'm like, wow, I can see that thing helping me help my community in sending these images and information so I can get more help to actually get these folks off the island and the help they need.
And so you started with an observation that your function on Lanai could be enhanced by this capability. It's been 4 years, and you've actually done some demonstrations on Lanai.
Yep. Last year, 2016, in remembrance of the Maui plane crash of the Lanai Planning Commission, that September 14th of last year, we flew the first drone at an airport for a airport triannual exercise drill. And we executed our plan as normal, and we only added the UAS block, and it only benefited the whole incident command system and made it quicker.
So once again, you stayed within the constraints, didn't challenge them, you worked with them, and also dealt with the incident command system and recognized the value it provides and didn't challenge that, but worked within it and enhanced the operation at the airport.
Yep, the drone actually became a tool that was needed, plugged in, and gained the information that was needed. And we were able to make the right decisions and quicker response time.
So let's take the thought you had at the first half of the show. We talked about generating three-dimensional imagery of the surrounds, the schools and the recreation or the residential areas, in preparation for any disaster might occur. Let's think about that as being testable on Lanai. Mm-hmm. Lanai is. You got the community already working in the right direction. You got the school system working in the right direction. The single school. And so why not think of that as the place to start this out?
That's part of our plans for next year. One of it is the senior project for the kids, that they go out and they actually map sections of the island. And over time, every class that comes up, that group who chooses that subject, they go out and they do a section and research, and over time, we'll collect it in a database and stitch it over time, and we'll see how much is done. So by generation's end, you'll have the whole island mapped somehow, some way.
And this could become a leadership item for the rest of the state to see, the rest of the country to see, for that matter, in the proper use within the rules, and as an educational piece, as a cross tie between all the departments within the educational system, right here in Lanai, or right here in Fairbanks, as the case may be. But Fairbanks and Lanai aren't that different, right?
Nope.
So it can be done here as well. But once again, Lanai is a great place to start. So if we thought about that, what do we need in terms of equipment or training or workshop areas or square footage of resources in order to do that, do you think, on Lanai?
Well,
we're talking about Lanai City, basically. Right?
Yep, basically Lanai City. And what I'm looking for is folks in the industry that are experts in their field of the computer softwares, anything that these children may need to understand, I'll go out and I'll find that person that can come in and visit them.
What if we did this? I'm just imagining here. I'm getting like you, okay, imagining things that are interesting here. But what if we had, there's several different software sets and vendors that do three-dimensional analysis. What if we had all of them, invite them all out?
I did. I actually met two at InterDrone that they're coming up with a school package that will let the kids use it for free. And she will actually do classes on YouTube, and our kids can watch it.
And it would be possible to have different software vendors provide software and let the kids, let the software vendor learn how it works in the hands of the kids or the school system, and let the kids learn these, frankly, really advanced methods of analysis that can be executed straightforwardly.
Yeah.
So what a great laboratory for seeing if these systems work in the hands of the public. So I could think of a couple of different vendors, four or five of them maybe, or something like that, and have almost a competition. But we certainly find out what works and what doesn't work.
Exactly. It'd be nice to see the end product of what maps from what companies turn out to be what.
Mm-hmm. And this would actually be a kind of an interesting career path for kids who might want to become surveyors or software engineers or even UAS designers, this sort of thing, because they could think of how the UAS ought to be made better. You could evaluate everything in the whole workflow in this process on Lanai.
Exactly. I want to make a shout out to Stacy Purdy and my kids on Lanai. Just want to say hi. From Alaska, I'll be home soon. And my business partners, Mike and Ellen. Aloha.
Especially little Kiavi.
He's running around.
Right? Yeah.
Yep.
Big smile on his face in that yellow truck.
Yep.
Yeah, we were all over Lanai at Kiavi's birthday party 2 weeks ago. And since that time, you've been in Vegas, you've been in up in Fairbanks.
Yep.
And you're finally going to get back home to the Aina this Sunday.
Sunday.
Well, that's another piece to mention here about the whole game of UAS-ism or drone-ism. There's conferences every week somewhere. And you were in Vegas last week. You're in Fairbanks this week. Who knows where you could be next week if you were hitting all these conferences.
Exactly. I wouldn't be in Hawaii.
All right. So one unfortunate side of this is that there is all this travel required to get this game to this point in time. But that's the only way to really share information is sit down, talk to people, and get on this show and tell the story. But
the story.
I really like the idea you've generated, George. I really like the idea of Lanai as a test place to evaluate all these issues. You almost can't fail because if something doesn't work, let's fix it.
Exactly.
And it's small enough that you can fix and recover fairly quickly, unlike, say, Chicago, where if it failed, you would have a serious issue. But Lanai as a test base, I'm saying it again, I can understand that myself, Lanai and the school system and the population as a test basis for systems or software performing highly valuable public service in a way that hasn't been performed before, but has the motivation, as we talked at the beginning of the program, because FEMA will pay attention to that. People will get benefited by dollars in their bank account should anything ever happen.
And it's good for all. That's the key. It's for everybody.
Once it gets developed on Lanai, then that whole business model and the operational model and the software that works could be transferred elsewhere. And if vendors want to improve their software, go back to Lanai again. Lanai becomes the recycling point where all this work happens. Kids through the STEM program graduate, go on to college, and come back.
Or I can hire them.
All right, yeah.
I can pick the best.
Yeah, okay. And then, of course, the public safety on Lanai gets improved in the process. So we've, in this short half hour here, George, your brilliance has once again poured forth. That should be a really easy sell to get this program to work with the various vendors we have. And certainly the school system ought to be very interested in this. And I would think even our legal profession would be looking forward to it as a way to test the ideas of how we're going to protect information of this type that has potential value to people who want to misuse it. So we have just a lot of factors here all coming together. And I'll say it once again, Lanai is a perfect place to run this stuff out and check it out. So with that, we've exhausted far beyond our three bright ideas for one George Purdy visit here.
Well, I got to squeeze it in when I can.
Okay. And George Purdy, finally, get you out here in the flesh, real on our show. And at this point, folks, we'll take the studio here north of the Arctic Circle in Fairbanks, Alaska. And we're going to hustle back inside where it's a bit warmer, and we'll see you all next week.